Hi everyone, in this lecture we'll talk about feet of distress in lathe. Feet of distress include any condition that may result in fetal hypoxia. And fetal hypoxia is a very risky condition because if it is not treated appropriately, it may result in fetal neurological damage or even death. Fetal neurological damage may lead to cerebral palsy and its complication. Pregnancies more liable to develop fetal distress include women with diabetes, whether chronic diabetes or gestational, hypertensive disorders in pregnancy, whether pre-pregnancy hypertension or preeclampsia, gestational hypertension, maternal infection, whatever the cause, women with hemoglobinopathy such as sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, women with chronic substance abuse such as cocaine, postterm pregnancy, women with multiple pregnancy, intrauterine growth retardation because already the fetal sphere has decreased oxygen reserve, so more liable for fetal distress in labor. Prolonged labor, especially with the use of Pitocin and uterine hyperstimulation, or precipitate labor, because as we know, with each uterine contraction, there is decrease in blood flow to the fetus due to myometrial contraction. This results in compression of the blood vessel that conducts the blood to the fetus. So if the fetus is already has hypoxia, this will result in more hypoxia. And even in healthy fetus, prolonged labor with a prolonged decrease of blood flow to the fetus may result in fetal hypoxia. Other risk factors include cord prolapse. In both cases, cord prolapse and placental abruption, there will be decreased blood supply to the fetus. Cord prolapse due to cord compression, and here because of premature placental separation. As we said, maternal infection or biorexia, whatever the cause. Chorioamnionitis, this is risky for the fetus and the mother. Meconium stained lichen, this indicates fetal distress as we will see later. Antenatal and intrapartum hemorrhage. Hypoxia of the fetus will result in anaerobic metabolism to decrease consumption of oxygen. This will lead to increase the production of lactic acid and result in decrease in the pH. So metabolic acidosis will develop in the fetus. Such acidosis will stimulate sympathetic nervous system, resulting in fetal tachycardia. So fetal tachycardia indicate acute hypoxia of the fetus. If the hypoxia is not corrected, the cause of hypoxia is not corrected, profound acidosis will result, and this will cause the stimulation of the vagus nerve. So parasympathetic nervous system will stimulate it later on, causing fetal bradycardia, and also stimulate peristalsis of the bowel, resulting in passage of meconium in neutral. Usually, normally, the meconium passes after delivery. However, in this case, meconium will pass in neutral. So presence of meconium stained lichen is one of the signs of fetal distress and hypoxia. In extreme condition, if the condition is not corrected, acidosis may result in neurological damage, cerebral palsy, and even death of the fetus. After delivery, neonatal asphyxia usually detected through the Apgar score. This depends on different parameters, including heart rate of the neonate, the breathing rate, the reflexes, tone of the fetus, color of the body. So the Apgar score was 8 to 10, this is normal. 4 to 7 indicates mild asphyxia. If less than 3, 3 or less indicates severe asphyxia. What is the effect of fetal asphyxia? Usually fetal asphyxia or hypoxia is a serious condition if not corrected, and may result in different neonatal complications, including hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, which may result in cerebral palsy and neonatal seizures. Meconium aspiration syndrome. As we said, meconium may pass due to parasympathetic stimulation. The fetus pass meconium in utero. Meconium is chemical condition that cause irritation to the lungs, so may result in chemical pneumonitis, which is a risky condition, which may be complicated by bacterial pneumonitis. Assessment of fetal well-being during labor include either intermittent auscultation of the fetal heart or continuous electronic monitoring, scalp pH measurement, or assessment of the color of lichen. For low risk group, that is to say women that don't have the risk factor that we already mentioned, usually we use intermittent auscultation of the fetal heart rate as monitoring during labor by using Binarc or handheld Doppler. And usually we check fetal heart for at least 1 minute after a contraction. Why after the contraction? Because during contraction, as we said, myometrial contraction will result in compression of the blood vessel that conducts the blood to the fetus. So there is already a degree of fetal hypoxia with decrease in blood supply during contraction. The changes in the fetal heart would occur at this period. So usually after contraction, we monitor the fetal heart for at least 1 minute. Usually every 15 to 30 minutes in the first stage of labor and every 5 minutes in the second stage of labor. Routine continuous electronic fetal monitoring is not recommended for low-risk group. Regarding continuous electronic fetal heart monitoring, usually this is used for high-risk group. Sometimes we use it for low-risk group if they develop intrapartum risk factor, that is to say risk factor during delivery. During labor, such as if we start Pitocin, giving them Pitocin, or the latter was meconium stained, or they develop vaginal bleeding, or maternal biopsy developed during labor. Or when we monitor the fetal heart during intermittent method, we notice that there is abnormality in the fetal heart, whether bradycardia, tachycardia, we should shift to continuous electronic monitoring. For interpretation of cardiac echography, which is the continuous electronic fetal monitoring, the normal CTG includes, first of all, we have to look for 4 parameters in the CTG: heart rate, acceleration, deceleration, and baseline variability. Heart rate is normally 110 to 160, or some said to 150 beats per minute. Absence of deceleration, which is the decrease in the heart rate by 15 beats per minute for at least 15 seconds. Presence of acceleration, which is the presence of the increase in the heart rate for at least 15 beats per minute for at least 15 seconds. Regarding the presence of acceleration during labor is not an essential feature. That is to say, the absence of acceleration doesn't mean that it is pathological CTG. Baseline variability, which is the variation from beat to beat, should be from 5 to 25 beats per minute. If one of these parameters is abnormal, this is suspicious. If 2 or more abnormal, this is the pathological CTG. If CTG shows that there is simple variable deceleration or early deceleration later on in labor after engagement of the head, this is usually is not sign of fetal distress. However, if the variable or early deceleration was recurrent and prolonged, this is maybe of significance. If CTG is suspicious, let's say one of these parameters is abnormal, we may continue on CTG. However, if it is pathological, we have to look for reversible causes, such as uterine hyperstimulation, maternal hypotension, and we should perform vaginal examination to exclude cordial prolapse and also to detect cervical dilatation. If the cervix is fully dilated, here we may perform instrumental delivery. If other parameters required for instrumental delivery is available, including the station, by either ventouse or forceps. If not, if the cervix is not fully dilated, the next step would be fetal blood sampling. So, pathological CTG, and the woman has not imminent delivery in short time, we have to perform fetal blood sampling. These are examples of CTG. The first one on the left side, this indicates normal CTG. The lower aspect of the image, this is the tachography. This records uterine contraction. The elevation means uterine contraction. The upper part indicates fetal heart. In the left side, this is normal fetal heart function with normal rate ranging from 110 to 150 or 60. And there is acceleration, as we see. There is increase in the heart rate by at least 15 beats per minute for at least 15 seconds. And also there is normal baseline variability. As we see, it is not straight line. There is curve up and down. This is the normal on the left. On the right side, as we see, this is what we call late deceleration. This means that the onset of deceleration starts with the end of uterine contraction. So the peak of uterine contraction is at the end of the peak, start the decrease in the heart rate of the fetus. Also, we see that there is decrease in the baseline variability. So this is a pathological CTG. Regarding late deceleration in the previous slide, usually late deceleration occurs when there is a decrease in the uteroplacental perfusion, and it is the most risky type of deceleration. This type of, or this example of CTG shows variable deceleration. It has a variable relationship with uterine contraction. It could occur with uterine contraction, after, and also different, it could be U-shape, V-shape. This may occur due to cord compression. This slide shows early deceleration. Usually early deceleration occurs when there is engagement of the head and there is head compression. So usually it occurs in late endeavor. So it was simple and non-recurrent, usually it is of little or no significance. In early deceleration, usually, as we see, the start of fetal deceleration occurs with the start of uterine contraction and usually decrease or return to the baseline with the end of uterine contraction. As we said, if the woman has abnormal CTG and the reversible cause is corrected and the stomach is abnormal and the woman is not fully dilated, in this case, we have to perform fetal blood sampling by taking the blood from the fetus, as we said, by using a venoscope and light source. Here, the membrane should be ruptured and at least 3 to 4 cm dilatation of the cervix. And by scalpel, we made small cut in the fetal scalp and aspirate blood. If the fetal pH measurement is more than 7.25, this is the normal. So we allow labor to continue, but I have to repeat the fetal blood sampling after 30 to 60 minutes, depending on the CTG. CTG returned to normal, we repeat it after 60 minutes. If it's still pathological, I should repeat it after 30 minutes. This is because at this time the pH is normal, but it could be that the fetus has hypoxia but not reached the degree of acidosis yet, and after period he will develop acidosis, so it should be repeated. If pH is less than 7.2, this indicates fetal hypoxia and acidosis, so immediate delivery is required. If the mother has full cervical dilatation and I want to accelerate labor, I may use instrumental delivery, whether forceps or ventures. If she is not fully dilated, cesarean section is required. If pH is between 7.2 to 7.25, this is the borderline, I have to repeat the fetal blood sampling after 30 minutes. If there is abnormality in the fetal heart monitoring, I should look for the reversible causes and correct them. This includes maternal dehydration, hypotension, cord prolapse, uterine hyperstimulation. So, maternal dehydration is corrected by IV fluid. The same as for maternal hypotension, which usually results from epidural analgesia, which is used for pain relief during labor. If the woman stay in supine position for a prolonged period, this will result in decreased compression of the aorta and inferior vena cava and decreased blood supply to the fetus. So the woman should turn to one of her sides, especially the left side. Also, maternal oxygenation to increase oxygen saturation, maternal oxygen saturation, and so increase the oxygen delivered to the fetus. Pelvic examination to detect if there is cord presentation or cord prolapse. If there is uterine hyperstimulation, we have to stop oxytocin infusion and give subcutaneous sterbutaline 250 micrograms subcutaneously and acceleration of delivery by instrumental delivery.